Liebe Kolleginnen und Kollegen, liebe Freunde des Amboss Studientelegramms, Markus at Home welcomes in Irvine, California, Dr. Cam Callender Zardy, and in Reno, Nevada, Dr. David St. Jules, with whom we would like to discuss the role of dietary intake of potassium in patients with chronic kidney disease. Cam, David, it's a privilege for us to have you at this very early hour in your Californian and Nevada morning. Thanks for being with us. Dr. Callender Zardy is professor of medicine at the Division of Nephrology, Hypertension, and Kidney Transplantation at the University of California. And Dr. St. Jules is an assistant professor at the Department of Nutrition at the University of Nevada. They represent two generations of global leaders in the field of kidney disease nutrition. And actually, when David started his academic work around about 8 years ago, Dr. Callender Zardy had already published several hundreds of papers. And as of today, I think Dr. Callender Zardy is one of the very few active nephrologists who have more than 1,000 papers, including seminal reviews in Lancet and New England Journal. So again, it's a privilege for us to have you both today. Today, they work together in the editorial board of the Journal of Renal Nutrition with Dr. Callender Zardy as editor-in-chief and Dr. St. Jules as editor. My co-moderator today is Dr. Andreas Kronbichler, actually from Innsbruck, Austria, currently in Cambridge in the United Kingdom. So let's start off. And in the last years, you actually kind of challenged our conventional thinking in nephrology. Conventional thinking meaning that we used to learn and to teach that patients with advanced chronic kidney disease should limit their dietary potassium intake. And many of us regularly teach our patients to avoid nearly any kind of fruits and vegetables as far as possible. Now, both of you published a couple of articles in the last years that question this conventional approach. Maybe we start with David, because back in 2016, you analyzed the impact of dietary potassium on plasma potassium, and you found that this is a rather low association between the two of them. Would you give us some idea what is wrong with our conventional thinking?
Absolutely, and thank you again for having me here today. So, that was a bit of a surprise finding, and I was not expecting that. But when I found it, I started to think about, well, why might they not be related to one another? And one of the things to keep in mind is that we measure the blood potassium levels in hemodialysis patients monthly, right before they get hemodialysis. And the thinking at the time was that if you're eating too much potassium when you're on hemodialysis, that the potassium is accumulating in the body and in the blood between dialysis sessions. And I think the reason why we're not seeing a strong correlation there between the dietary potassium and the blood potassium levels is because there's other factors that are negating the effects of the dietary potassium. And also there are other factors that are maybe more important determinants of the blood potassium levels. And two factors in particular that have been highlighted a fair bit is the amount of potassium that's removed in stool. So we do know that when patients' kidneys fail, that the bowels actually take over a lot of the maintaining the external potassium balance, removing potassium from the body. And so if there's, and the ability of the bowels to remove potassium is quite high, and so it can actually prevent potassium from accumulating. The other factor is the potassium distribution in the body. So 98% of the potassium in the body is actually found inside cells. And so even small differences in terms of the distribution of potassium in and out of cells can make a big difference in terms of the blood potassium levels. And so there are other dietary factors that can affect both of those things, and they may be actually sort of negating the effect of the dietary potassium.
Are all sources of dietary potassium equal, or should we distinguish plant-based and animal-based diets?
I think this is a really great question. I know I've seen a lot in the literature lately talking about plant-based versus animal-based. For my own purposes, I don't tend to distinguish them quite that way. I think when we think about hyperkalemia, it's better to think about the way in which foods come together in meals and the overall dietary pattern, because you know you can have plant-based foods that may be problematic, and you can have animal-based foods that can be problematic, depending on what factors are sort of driving the high blood potassiums. Some other things to consider where plant-based may be a bit better, and where this thinking is coming from, is that plant-based tends to be more alkaline. Particularly fruits and vegetables tend to be base forming in the body. And so they can help negate some of the metabolic acidosis that causes potassium to leak out of cells and have that high potassium within the blood. And then the other thing about plants is that they have dietary fiber. And so that fiber may increase the amount of potassium removed in stool. And so I think that's where that thinking comes from. But for me, I do think it has a lot more to do with the way in which the meal comes together, because there are some dietary things that can help prevent the potassium from getting too high after a meal. And that's also important to consider.
And should we distinguish between kind of low potassium fruits and vegetables and high potassium fruits and vegetables? Because this is quite difficult actually to explain to patients, and this takes a lot of our time. Do you still recommend us to do like that?
I do think it's important for patients to have their diets assessed by somebody who understands high and low potassium fruits and vegetables, in order to make sure that there's nothing going on in the patient's diet that could be causing a lot of problems. So in particular, if patients are eating very large portions at one time, certainly there are some fruits and vegetables that could be problematic. Also, if they're having certain forms of fruits and vegetables like dried fruit or fruit juices, those can be more of a problem. But in terms of teaching patients that sort of the traditional way of these are foods to avoid and these are foods to consume, I think a more conventional way of thinking of it is if a patient has large portions, problems with portion control, then that might be where you could focus on, is not necessarily saying you can't have potatoes, but maybe having a smaller portion of potatoes so that you don't get too much potassium at one time.
So another important question, of course, we are improving our patient care and we also stimulate them to exercise regularly. What is the role of regular exercise in CKD patients with hyperkalemia? And do you have any preferences, what you recommend, actually, which kind of exercise should patients do?
I recently did a review article with some colleagues on exercise and hyperkalemia, and I'll throw out some ideas and then see if Dr. Kalantar Zadeh has some additional things he wants to add. In my paper, I talk about the fact that when people are exercising, when their muscles are contracting, potassium is leaking out of the muscle cells, and that actually causes a temporary increase in blood potassium levels. And historically, there was concerns about exercise-induced hyperkalemia. What I talked about in that paper was this idea that exercise may actually be beneficial in hyperkalemia management. And the reason is there's a few different mechanisms, but the one that I think I'll focus on here is that in order to adapt to exercise, one of the things that happens with muscle adaptation is that it increases the expression of the sodium-potassium ATPase transporter on the muscle cells. And that transporter is actually important for moving potassium into cells after a meal. And it also helps the person adapt to the exercise so that the potassium, although it's leaking out of the muscle cells, it gets put back into the cells. And so it prevents that exercise-induced hyperkalemia. So I think actually some exercise in controlled amounts and appropriate amounts may actually be beneficial in terms of hyperkalemia management.
So now we need the nephrologist cam. There's a lot of discussion when it comes to choosing the potassium concentration of our dialysate. So there are people kind of favoring the 2.0K, others who prefer a 3.0 or even 4.0. So what would you recommend if we kind of put less emphasis on avoiding fruits and vegetables? Where should we go with a dialysate potassium?
Erstens bedanke ich mich herzlich für die Gelegenheit, mit deutschsprachigen Kollegen und Kolleginnen nochmals verbunden zu sein. Es ist eine große Ehre für mich. So von nun an auf Deutsch, auf Englisch. So I appreciate. So the what David said is very important. However, even for dialysis patients, I'm not sure if we have ever helped them by depriving them of a zero potassium diet, no potassium diet. If anything, I would argue for the past 25 years, I've been involved in providing help to dialysis patients from Nuremberg, Germany to New York to San Francisco and now Los Angeles and Orange County. I feel sometimes in 25 years, I have done more harm by giving them this so-called renal diet, which I learned again back in Nuremberg, but the entire planet is the same. So as David astutely alluded to, are there really potassium load from the diet? And are there data suggesting that dialysis patients who eat the so-called high potassium diet have more hyperkalemia, right? And those who are more adherent, they have less. For instance, again, Dr. Sanjul's mentioned about the gastrointestinal tract and high fiber, something that I would like to add. High fiber diet is going to help these patients to hopefully have less constipation, plus improving gut microbiome. And these are things that means constipation is more likely to be associated with hyperkalemia in dialysis patients, as well as in CKD patients, not on dialysis. And some data have shown that higher protein intake, actually higher animal-based protein intake, is more associated with hyperkalemia than all these good foods that we go around during our dialysis rounds and say no banana, no avocado, no peach, no oranges. It really hurts. It hurts me. I'm heartbroken each time I see that. So I'm going to stop here. Thank you.
Could I would continue with the question? It was very pleasant to hear this statement. Should we continue to check potassium intake regularly in our CKD patients? And if yes, by food questionnaires, dietary calls, spot urine samples, or are you performing 24-hour urine collections?
So let me answer this, and then we can see what David says. The answer is we should check potassium in the blood, which we do. We do it once a month in dialysis centers. We do it every 3 months in our CKD clinics. Patients come, and we have great dietitians who talk with the patients. But the question is, should we go and tell the patient, since your potassium is high now, you should not eat all these highly valuable food items, right? Everything that is heart healthy, we're going to say no. Or should we ask our dietitian experts, dietitians, nurses, and as well as ourselves, and people like Dr. Sanjus have expertise to help us with a different type of diet that is not potassium-centric diet, but it's a diet that is kidney-centric, right? So the answer is yes, we still need to look at these things. And also, I think Dr. David Sanjul's mentioned that, yes, there are some, even fruits and vegetables, we should consider with maybe more cautious approach, such as dried food, right? And even that, I'm not sure, actually. If dried food could cause less constipation, we should think about this. But that's a source. Or added potassium to diet. Believe it or not, added phosphorus and potassium, these are preservatives, right? Preservatives, they should avoid those things. We should ask our dietitians to focus on those types of diets.
David, would you recommend regularly, you as a nutrition, regularly to check for 24-hour urine samples in order to have an idea of potassium intake and surely also sodium intake, or would you also focus upon blood values and some kind of dietary recall?
So I can throw in an additional thought in this. I agree completely with what Dr. Kalantar Zadeh mentioned right there, which is that we really need to stop thinking about it as a low potassium diet, and it needs to be thought of as a diet for managing hyperkalemia and more broadly, not just hyperkalemia, because we know our patients have a lot of issues going on. In terms of what's the right dietary approach, I think a urinary potassium in somebody who's not on dialysis could be a nice luxury item. But for me, I really think that because, as Dr. Kalantarzadeh mentioned, we have to think about things like potassium additives, that you really can't get at that with a food frequency questionnaire. So it really does require, I think, some of those more detailed methods like a food record or a food diary or a diet history. So I think that those are going to be more beneficial in terms of trying to figure out if there is something in the diet that's causing a problem.
If I could also add maybe that what David says, I'm going to say something he may be disappointed that in my clinic, people fly from all over the country to see me because they think I'm one of very few nephrologists who has nutritional management of CKD with low protein diet, more plants, less animal-based protein. And one of the things I measure every 3 months is 24-hour urine, 24-hour nitrogen, 24-hour sodium, 24-hour potassium in the urine. Nitrogen to estimate the amount of protein intake, because I ask my patients to eat less than 0.8 grams per kilogram per day. That also helps with potassium controlling. Sodium because of low salt, if possible, and potassium. Now, think about this, and you're going to be surprised or shocked. I measure urinary potassium to make sure they eat as high as 3 to 4 grams of potassium. When it's low, I said, hey, that means you're not eating enough fruits and vegetables. So, and then they said, Dr. Kalantar, I've looked all over the internet. They said low potassium. I said, no, you're flying to see me. I want you to forget everything that you're told. And I want you to eat as much fruits and vegetables until your urinary potassium shows that you're taking what is recommended.
So what are your ideas then on medication? Because there's also a lot of talk about the impact of certain medications, particularly in the field of heart failure, ACE inhibitors, ARBs, spironolactone. And we always have the issue of people coming to hospital with heart failure. They have potassium of, say, 5.5 or 5.6. What are your ideas? Should we stop all this cardioprotective medication? There are the very current ESC guidelines that suggest to stop them if somebody is above 5.5. And then my problem is that people usually forget to restart them once people are better. So what are your ideas for these people?
Well, if I could ask, if I could add here, same way that now that you mentioned medications, I'm going to say no. If actually medications are a more likely cause of hyperkalemia than diet. So we know that ACE inhibitors, ARBs, now that you mentioned medication, I'm going to say that there are also medications now called potassium binders, right? So if you're using those, you also feel free to use potassium binders, any brand you would like. I'm not here to say which one is better or worse. As long as a medication could help, the new potassium binders that are available, so we can use them. And yes, using ACE inhibitors, ARBs, and spironolactone and others, there are 10 to 12 class of medication that could cause hyperkalemia. So which one should we really go after, medications or diet? If you're asking me, diet is the priority. Don't go after restricting diet. Come up with medications, constellations that could allow patients to enjoy high plant-based or plant-dominant. We say plant-dominant means 50% of the source of protein should come from plants. Plant-dominant or Play-Doh. But I'm going to switch back to maybe turn over to Dr. Sanjul. So what would you recommend to your patients or when they come for that counseling?
I don't actually counsel patients, but if I was to put myself into sort of those shoes, I would agree. If I had a patient who came in with a hyperkalemia related to a medication, what we have there is an inappropriate retention of potassium in the body at the level of the kidneys. Me adjusting the dietary potassium intake is not necessarily going to change that equation. The problem is regulatory. And so I agree. I think some of the other methods, like looking at potassium exchange resins as a strategy to sort of undo the inappropriate retention, makes a lot of sense. And I would not be focusing much on the way of diet. I do think focusing on that healthy eating pattern, Play-Doh being a great example of a healthy eating pattern, a plant dominant diet, is a great approach for most patients and should not contribute to hyperkalemia. So.
So thank you. And I'm also referring to the potassium binders. So, and this is a more medical question for Dr. Kalanta. So they, are there specific potassium levels at which you would actually initiate these drugs? So in the CKD stage and also in the dialysis stage?
Well, Dr. Heine mentioned 5.5. Now, I usually, this is going to be also a little bit provocative what I'm going to say. For dialysis patients, I say 5 to 5.5 is the target, actually, if anything. That means, and studies have shown, the potassium level that's associated with the lowest mortality in dialysis patients is the one that we measure right before they start dialysis when it's around 5 to 5.3 or 5.5, right? Above 5.5, mortality starts going up, and below 5.0, mortality goes up. So what is high potassium for CKD patients? Usually anything about 5.5, for which is millimoles per liter or milliequivalents per liter. And above 6, maybe 5.5 to 6 is the gray zone for dialysis patients, but above 6 is hyperkalemia for dialysis patients. Maybe for CKD patients not on dialysis, 5.5 is already alarming. But the value of 5.5 or 5.3 is that this patient is now more likely to have surges above that, right? And if something happens to patients, bradycardia, heart standstill, then we are liable as physicians, or if a dietitian has not given the recommendation of low potassium diet. So these are all fears, and of course we have to deal with that. We have to be responsible, and we have to document that potassium is borderline high, and I have started certain changes. Number one, I told the patients avoid preserved food with a lot of potassium-based preservatives added. And I had made sure that patient is not using salt, potassium salt, because a lot of patients with kidney disease, they think they have to avoid salt, and they buy no sodium salt, and they have no idea that this is pure potassium, right? So, and I have to document all these things, and also potassium binders of your choice.
So there are novel ones that are rather expensive here in Europe, and I guess also in the States. There are elder ones which are rather cheap, which have some side effects. Would you, given these high costs of the novel ones, would you recommend each patient to go for the novel binders, or would you also say that the old ones may still be used if we make patients aware of potential side effects? So the old ones, think, like SPS, actually.
Yeah, I think both the older ones, that means sodium polystyrene, and the newer ones, they work. Now, of course, some of them have more sodium, lead to maybe some level of sodium burden. That's the ongoing discussion. Now, one thing that I try not to have any strong opinion which one is which one, because that becomes commercial. But Dr. Sanjul, also Sanjul's, has data about other ways to mobilize potassium. For example, exercise, right? So don't be surprised. Those who run half a mile, 1 mile, 2 mile, 3 miles, sometimes their potassium is so low, if you're not careful, you may have hypokalemic associated arrhythmias. And that I have seen, that there are case reports. So So let's take advantage of that by doing more exercise in a careful way, and hopefully Dr. Sanjul's research will expand on this. Maybe there is also another way to control potassium. That means by shifting potassium intracellularly, right? When you are angry, when your catecholamine surge is high, your potassium goes all intracellular. So am I correct, Dr. Sanjul? You have also looked at this potential.
Yes, absolutely. I tend to focus with the diet perspective on making sure that those base-forming fruits and vegetables are there. We know that patients do not eat even close to the recommended amount of fruits and vegetables. And then also avoiding overconsumption of some of those acidic foods, which tends to be your animal-based protein foods like meat and eggs and things like that. So making sure that there's a good balance there is really important. And then definitely the exercise, getting that sort of stimulated response that helps the body better able to handle potassium and put it intracellularly, I think is something that I haven't seen a lot of research on, but the available study that did look at this, it looked really positive in terms of the potassium levels went from 5.1 to 4.5 to 4.6, 3 months in a row. Throughout the entire intervention, the remainder of the months, the potassium levels stayed around that 4.5 to 4.6 range, suggesting that, and we don't know what the individual patients were, that could have been some patients with very high values coming down, which would be really great. So I think we need a lot more research on this to really know for sure, but I think it's an interesting idea and another benefit of exercise, which is already a good thing for patients.
Good. So one more question from my side, and also referring more to the medical perspective. So in your clinic, when you approach a patient with CKD and hyperkalemia, how much time do you spend to discuss diet with your patient? And you also referred to dietitians that they are excellent at your clinical practice. How much time do they spend with the patient to improve compliance and explain the dietary restrictions they do have?
Well, we still tell the patient, say that, look, the state-of-the-art approach is to lower potassium, rich diet. And then both myself and our dietitians tell the patients that, look, this is the list of high potassium items, mostly are fresh fruits and vegetables. However, there is no ban that from now on you're not allowed to look at avocado because it's in the red list. If you do it in a balanced way and plus everything else, and high fiber diet is still very important. So our approach is a balanced approach to diet, not a restrictive approach that has been around for the past 30 years.
So in the end, we would like to look somewhat into the future. So my last but one question would be, do you expect us to see in the next months or so a couple of papers how dietary changes occurred during the pandemic and how far in the last 15 or so months people changed the way they eat and in how far this may allow us to better understand the impact of potassium intake and surely also other components of food upon blood levels? Are you aware, again, as you are the editor-in-chief and the editor of the most important journal in this field, that we will see a couple of data in the next months?
The answer is we're going to continue to see more papers and research on plant versus animal-based diet, more research on gut microbiome, what diets change that. And also, yes, more papers are coming about the questions that experts like Dr. Sanjul are dealing with them is if the diet really determines potassium, burden of potassium, which diet, and how we can clarify what we followed for the past 30 years without having data. So now based on these interactions and feedback, I'm going to make sure that we're going to see even more papers about dietary potassium.
And last question. There are some people suggesting that we may have some point of care measurements with potassium, maybe even at home, that people check their potassium levels regularly. Do you think that this may be a good approach for the future, or should we avoid to overstress checking blood levels in these patients?
No, I think it's a great idea. If at some point, if we can come up with a way that patient can check potassium, because if I say that, hey, I can't even look at banana or avocado, but at the same time, if I check my potassium and if it's 4.1, 4.8, then I say, hey, today I can actually carefully enjoy more healthy food, right? So if knowledge is always power, if it's done in a great way. So I would advocate that.
So thanks a lot. It was really a pleasure to talk to the two of you, and thanks for all the brilliant contributions in the last years and the last decades. Have a nice morning in Nevada, in California, and hopefully we're looking forward to see you one day again in presence, particularly Camus here in Germany. And just to give an idea why you speak that good German, you have been in medical school in, I think, in Nuremberg, Erlangen, and also in Bonn, if I'm right.
That's correct.
So we are looking forward to see you one day back in Germany, and David, surely also one day here in Germany. Have a good day. Thanks a lot for taking the time for being with us. Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it.